matter who you are
or where you are on life's journey.
You are welcome here
by the five of us
and the six communities we represent.
No matter how long it's been,
no matter how far you've wandered,
no matter what you've done or what you think you might have done wrong,
you are welcomed here.
Here, your past is forgotten.
You're your mistakes are forgiven.
Here, differences are accepted. Wounds are healed.
Brokenness is mended.
So you can be being loud and proud.
Or reserved and unperturbed.
Just so you know, you are welcome.
So welcome.
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 Welcome. Welcome. Nurturing God, as we gather together, we praise you for this day and your purpose for it. Reset our agendas as we sit in your presence. For you assure us that where two or more are gathered in your name, you are there. Recalibrate our intentions and refocus our hearts. Your will for our lives does not always reflect our plans. Change them to reflect your will. Help us to understand that we don't need full clarity to walk into the unique purpose you've inlaid in our lives. Lift our eyes to seek you first today and always, surrendering our need to achieve, understand, and be known. Shift our perspective to seek your peace above all else. In every situation we ponder in our daily lives, let the Holy Spirit translate your commands. Give us renewed strength and godly courage to obey you without questioning. Forgive us for striving beyond our means, worrying and forcing results. Only you know what lies ahead. You are our heavenly guide, just and righteous. Though our circumstances will be unfair from time to time in this life, you are always our unwavering protector and shield. Help us to keep the words of King David fresh in our minds and renew our hearts to the tune of your truth. I lie down and sleep, I wake up again because the Lord sustains me. Let your peace rain down on us today as we seek you more than anything else. In Jesus' name, amen.
You, O Lord, I am born.
Gracious God, you call us to live by faith, but so often we walk by sight. We want fact to be truth, and truth to be obvious. We seek answers that resemble what already lies in our field of vision. We value clarity more than reality, what we can see more than what may be, what conforms to our picture more than to what surprises, challenges, or confounds us. Light of the world, forgive us when we give privilege to only our own sight and thus become blind. Open our eyes to you, to your deeper truth, and to your life within us, so that we might look around us and within us and see anew. In faith, may we come to know you more fully, to love more deeply, and to see the world and everyone in it as you do, according to your grace. For regardless of how we see, we are loved by Christ, who came to bring sight to the blind in mind and in spirit, who knows our blind spots and gives us new vision. May we learn to see with the eyes of Christ. Alleluia.
Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing in the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Looking back on things now, after a quarter of a century or more has passed, I think I could have handled his constantly disapproving glances and sighs and harumphs that he always managed to flash my way. I could have handled that, if that's all there were to it. But he could never be satisfied with just embodying his sanctimonious disapproval. He always had to put it into words. If he weren't damning me with faint praise, he was tossing out one insincere compliment after another, each always followed by the caveat, by the qualifier. But you see, I would have never done it that way. So from almost the first moment I met him, I took an instant disliking to him. Now to be sure, though I didn't like him one bit, I absolutely adored his wife. She was always so gracious, so kind and affirming. I remember after the first sermon I ever preached in that church, she came up afterwards and said, "Now you're cooking. You're cooking with gas." I had never heard that expression before, but her gentle eyes, her tender handshake, Her warm smile left no doubt that cooking with gas was more than a good thing. It was a great thing. Although I tried hard to hide my dislike and mask my disdain of him from everybody, but especially from her, she must have sensed it. It wasn't too long after that first sermon that I heard a knock at my study door. To my pleasant surprise, there she was, with her gentle eyes and tender handshake and warm smile. Now, she was alone, and she had come just to visit me, maybe even to tell me again about how I was cooking with gas. So I gladly welcomed her in and offered her a seat. We had barely exchanged pleasantries before she got right to the point. And she said, "You'll have to excuse my husband." She said, "No, you need to understand. You just have to understand. He's not well. He's not been well for a long time." She then shared with me the story of her husband's tortured life. Emotionally fragile, often teetering right at the edge of insanity, in and out of institutions over most of the past half century, including 2.5 years of brutal insulin shock therapy. Even when he was at his best and most whole, he could hardly function. He could barely work, always himself anxious and embittered, always embittering and making anxious everyone around him. She went on to say that his was a life forever scarred by the trauma of what he had seen and what he had done as an Army chaplain, serving in the Pacific during the last year or so of World War II. Even before he was ever called to do what chaplains really do, bind up the battered, broken bodies of young men or endure the cries of the dying, cradling in their arms as they breathe their last, even before he did any of that, he watched helplessly as a small group of U.S. servicemen knifed and killed two of their New Zealand allies in a drunken barroom brawl. But she said, the one saving grace for him, the one thing that kept him going and gave him hope year after year after year, was the memory of what he was asked to do the morning of August the 6th, 1945. There on Tinian Island, he blessed the bread, and he shared the cup of communion with the crew of the Enola Gay, blessing not their atomic bomb, nor their mission, nor the destruction that they would visit on Hiroshima, but only their lives. Lives like his life that would forever be changed by what they would see and do and experience and feel that day. So she said, embittered and embittering though he certainly was, scarred by what he did and changed by what he saw, he's never more whole, she said, never more at peace, never more hopeful and alive than when he's here in this space. Here with these people, the church, when he's sharing that cup and breaking that bread and offering up that life of suffering, his own life of suffering, to the hope that never fails. And it's those brief, fleeting moments of light and life that make all the darkness and despair, if not bearable, then at least endurable. Because in sharing the bread and the cup, he knows that God has destined him not to endure this suffering alone, but to be safe and saved by those very people who gather here to worship week in and week out. I just thought you needed to know, she said. You need to know. Now, I like to think that I look for the best in folks. Without too much trouble, I generally can find something virtuous, something noble, something righteous in just about everyone. But not in him. It shames me to say that I just missed it in him. He was broken, and all I saw was his bitterness. He was damaged, and all I felt was my own resentment. But armed with the knowledge of that one saving grace for him, with the memory of what he had been asked to do so long ago, taking hold of that grace that had taken hold of him, and bread broken and cup shared, I knew what I had to do. The very next time my congregation gathered at the table, James was with me. And for an instant, for one fleeting moment, he was no longer damaged, no longer broken or beaten down, but he was safe and sound and healed and hopeful. That just doesn't happen anywhere. That kind of being made whole just doesn't happen with any group of people. It happens here, in this virtual space, here with you people. Some lives that gather together here week in and week out are healthy and whole, but most are broken and damaged, hungry and hurting, persecuted and tormented, at least in some way. And we just seem to stumble through our lives in hopelessness and despair. But here in this space, here with each other, God's grace is poured out on our lives. And God's grace shatters our despair with a hope that never fails. Even when evil seems to hold sway and chaos threatens to crush us, we know that our God has the last word, keeping us faithful as we watch and wait for God's coming realm, doing what we do best, encouraging each other, nurturing each other, and forgiving and affirming and transforming each other in Christ Jesus our Lord. And when that happens, you're cooking with gas. Take it from me, that's a great thing. Now we live in amazing times with a world of information at our fingertips. So all week I have been Googling his name, James Albert Carlin. His wartime exploits were indeed the stuff of legend. That barroom brawl, you can find out all about it. And you can read how James captivated a coroner's inquest, giving colorful and theatrical testimony of what he had witnessed. You can even read where he was awarded the Bronze Star for valor in military operations against the enemy. I don't know much about such things. I have no idea what James did, but I would bet that not too many chaplains were so decorated. But the one saving grace for him, the one thing that kept him going year after year after year, was the memory of what he was asked to do, what he was convinced he did do, the morning of August the 6th, 1945, serve communion to the crew of the Enola Gay. But that never happened. That never happened. It was just a grand delusion that he clung to help him live with what he did do and what he had seen done there in the Pacific. But what was real and far from delusional for James, if even for an instant, for one fleeting moment, was whenever he gathered in a space not unlike this space, with a people not unlike you people, he was no longer damaged, no longer broken, no longer beaten down, but he was healed and made whole. There in that space, there with that group of people, he became good and acceptable and whole and perfect and righteous in God's sight. And I'm here to tell you, here in this space, here with each other, wounds are washed, brokenness is mended, grief is consoled. Here with you, empty spirits are filled, lonely hearts are embraced, the hungry are fed, the thirsty given drink. Here with you, here with each other, for an instant, for one fleeting moment, we are no longer damaged, broken, beaten down, but we are healed and we are made whole. And that's the hope that never fails. In the name of God most holy, of Jesus God's eternal word, and of the Holy Spirit, the fire of God's love. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give thanks to you, our eternal and triune God.
For out of love you created the universe. From every unseen electron buzzing about to every vast galaxy ablaze with stars.
You created us to bear your image and share your delight in what you had made. When we rebelled against your will, You did not lash out in righteous indignation, but patiently, earnestly, you called us back to yourself.
While we were still sinners, still enmeshed in selfishness and guilt, still driven by fear and shame, Christ died for us.
This outpouring of divine love sets our feet in a firm foundation of God's grace and fills us with a hope. And hope endures forever. It's the assurance of finding welcome in God's glory.
Therefore, as we await that day, we sing. We join our voices with the voices of angels in a hymn of thanksgiving, gratitude, and praise.
Alleluia, alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia, alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia, holy, holy, you are Lord God the Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy. You are Lord God, the Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Amen. Alleluia. Alleluia. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia, alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Alleluia, holy, holy, you are Lord God the Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy, you are Lord God the Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy. You are Lord God the Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. You are Lord God the Almighty. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb. Amen.
And Linda Sue and Susan, you should
yes.
be on. All right. You want to lead us now in the with words of institution?
Yes, thank you. Now, if you would, please join me in the prayer that Jesus taught his followers. We'll be using debts and debtors. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And let us not fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you all to come to the table. It is set today for you. It is all prepared. So come as you are, because you are welcome here. On the same night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he blessed it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my sacrifice given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Now we will all take and eat. And in the same way, Jesus then raised the cup and he blessed it and he offered it to those gathered there, saying, "This is the cup of grace, the cup of mercy, and of eternal, unconditional love. Take and drink, remember and believe, for whenever you do so in my name, there will I be also."
Please join me in prayer. We give you thanks, O Lord, for this meal, for the way it enables us to eat and drink, scattered in many places, and yet eat and drink as one family, united in hope, united in love, united in grace. Amen.
Think of yourself as being an artistic person, but we hope to show you this morning that simply giving an offering can be considered an act of creativity. Of course, we often use artistic images to describe God, comparing the divine to a potter sculpting or a painter designing, or a musician composing works of art. Likewise, the three persons of the Trinity have been described as dancers, moving individually and yet together in a shared space. When we view the beauties of nature, a hopeful sunrise, a majestic mountain, or a glorious sunset, we may feel inspired and awestruck by God's handiwork. Yet we may forget that we too are a magnificent part of creation. As Ephesians 2:10 says, "We are God's work of art, created in Christ Jesus for the good works which God has already planned for us to do." Now, some of those good works that God has planned for us are achieved every time we contribute to our local churches with our offerings. And although we have been characterized as works of art ourselves, it is through our giving that we join with God in creating a more just and a kinder world. We may not think of ourselves as great artists like Vincent van Gogh or Claude Monet, but we may fashion lives that are worthy pieces of art when we live Christ-like lives. So thank you, fellow artists, for all of your good works, and especially for your offerings today.
May God bless you as loving creators who by your gifts make the world a more joyful and beautiful realm. May God guide your labors that teaches others to see the miraculous truth around them. May God ignite your inspiration that calls forth wonder and awe in your own living and that of others. In your hope and vision, we are reminded that life is holy. Bless all who create in your name, O God of creation. Pour your Spirit upon them, that their hearts may sing and their works be fulfilling. Amen.
Shelter. me.